Is your child driving you crazy? Does he have little circles under his eyes? How about the little red line across the nose? He's allergic. I'm telling you, are you here? Where are you, Robert?
Come on up and see me here for 1 second. It's fun being on TV. I'm on it every day, and I don't know what I'm going to do if they ever take me off. Robert, I have a tape of you that shows you, and you're not in a very good mood. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Did you ever see it?
No.
You never saw the tape? I don't even know how long ago this was. What a good-looking young man you are. I'll tell you this, though. Robert's mom has seen the world, and I'm sure his father, too. This was All right. If you're a parent, you may identify with this behavior. Roll that tape, if you will, please, Brian. Robert is getting a shot of wheat. Now, this is his behavior prior to the reaction to the shot. Now, what shall we call this? Is this hyperkinesis? Is this just Robert's natural behavior? Look at this undisciplined scribbling. Now, these are the longest moments in parenthood. This is quite clearly a very unhappy young man, not to be confused with the very emotionally secure fellow we see here in our studio today. This is Robert, who quite literally cannot help this antisocial behavior that we see here. And we are here to tell you today, along with an expert on this issue, is that if you're having trouble with your child, watch this. He's been asked to write his name, which he can do, incidentally. And that's as far as we get. He does not want any part of this. Look at now. What great shape you're in. Gloria Ciblo is here. You see, how old is Robert?
Robert is officially 8 as of Christmas. And we went, unfortunately, his behavior started to change at about 1.5 years. As an infant, he was quiet, he was ideal, he slept through the night. And then at an age of about 1.5 years, he began to get a little bit aggressive and a little bit hostile. His frustration level through the course of the next 3 years, he would cry without provocation. I would say, Robert, please just sit and watch Mr. Rogers. And he would sob and say, Mommy, I can't do it. And he genuinely meant he couldn't sit to do it.
He could not do it.
He could not sit to do it.
You know, I don't want to make a big thing out of this, but when you see what you've gone through, I mean, you must feel like this is nirvana for you. It is.
We had Robert diagnosed when he was 3.5 at Georgetown University, the Child Development Center, and they did a whole array of testing on Robert. And the bottom line of the studies was that he was normal, he was bright, and he may benefit from speech therapy. And at that point, I had reiterated to them, this behavior had now become a daily thing. It was just, when is it going to occur? It's not day in and day out. It became a daily thing with Robert. He would wake up calm, and by mid-morning, all of that sort of behavior would begin. We tried different ways of disciplining Robert. Nothing worked.
Yeah.
And finally, I mentioned to Georgetown, I said, Robert had broken 13 windows in 16 months. And I restated everything in terms of what you had seen here, and they threw out hyperactivity. They said, it doesn't exist. He is not a hyperactive child.
Uh-huh. How many years ago was this?
This was about 5 years ago.
What was the difference? What did you do?
I ran across your program quite by accident when Dr. Rapp was speaking. It was in May or March of 84. I was running out of the house. Here is Phil Donahue talking with this doctor that I had never heard about. And you were saying something, is your child hyperactive? And I said, I stopped what I was doing, monitored the program, and that's when I began to realize. Dr. Rapp at that point had a film clip of a 7-year-old boy who was nice and calm, and she fed him the red jello, and in about 40 minutes, he was sobbing, he was screaming, he was kicking, and I projected Robert up. I said, a couple of years from now, if his behavior continues, this 3.5-year-old will be that 7-year-old.
Now, we'll fill in the blanks later, but you took him off of wheat? He doesn't eat bread?
Oh, now Robert can have one of everything. Robert is fine. He can have his dairy products, he can have his wheat. What I did with Robert, I put him on the elimination diet, which Dr. Rack recommended. And I did it the first day he was out of regular school. So I monitor him day in and day out for the course of a summer, recording everything he ate.
Okay, but kindly simplify this for us. What did you take out of his diet that caused the most dramatic results?
Okay, eliminating the wheat and the milk. When I reintroduced wheat to Robert, in 22 minutes, the behavior was that of what you saw at the film clip. And when I reintroduced milk, which was he was off milk till August of that summer, Within 48 minutes, that behavior returned. I sent him to his room. He went upstairs and he put his head through the window face first. He had not had dairy products the course of that summer. And that was the summer out of, there were only four afternoons I could get that sort of behavior out of him. Three with the reintroduction of grains and one from the milk.
Is it, you know, who's, what kids are getting beat up? Abused. How much can you take of this? Is there a parent out there that hasn't at one time or another one? Most of us stop. Who isn't stopping? And the important thing is the kid can't help it. And we want to, we have one parent here whose child cried for 12 hours straight. 12 hours straight? Are the Dashes here? Hi.
Hi.
you can sit down here. Matt, Kevin? You, come on up. No, okay, you don't have to. That's all right. Listen, this is America. Let me show you a tape of Kevin. I should. It's okay with you, Mom. All right, here's Kevin. Look at this. He is consuming sugar cubes. Now what?
This is about an hour later.
This is an hour after the consumption of the sugar. Oh, do I recognize this child? No. Obviously, Kevin is not pleased. Now, our responsibility as adults is to, first of all, appreciate, look at this. Now, obviously, we want to put on this child the values and the decision-making capacity of an adult, but that's not fair. Kevin is not happy, and he cannot help his emotional condition right now. How many Kevins are out there right now being treated perhaps by medication? Is Ritalin a good idea? Look at this. How long after?
That's about 10 minutes after he received his treatment dose of an allergy extract of sugar, the thing that caused the reaction. We treated him with the same substance in the right dilution.
Mrs. Dash, you are Dr. Rapp's patient as well.
Yes, we are.
Would you kindly stand? I want to make sure we can see you. Was it milk that you took him off first, or how's this work? I mean, when did you say it's working?
When you have a child that wakes up in the morning, is happy and content and plays well, and then eats, and then turns miserable.
It's ogre-like.
Watch what they've just eaten. What was it they just ate?
Is it really that simple?
Yes.
What don't you give him now?
We really are careful with dairy products and sugar and food dyes. Those are brutal. And grains also are bad.
Dairy products, sugar, and grains, mm-hmm. and food dyes. Mm-hmm. What do you feed them?
Treat them and feed them.
In other words, it's possible to get around, to navigate
around. Just make sure the child doesn't get too much of any one thing. If Kevin has a dairy product in the morning, we're not going to drink milk at lunchtime. I can control it that way.
You must have been taken to the limit with this. You know what I mean, don't you, about your readiness?
There were times that I'd put him in his crib when he was a baby or in his room, and you literally go into the shower, and other mothers have told me this too. You go in the shower, you turn the shower on so your neighbors can't hear you, we're in an apartment, and cry. Or you put your face into a pillow and scream.
Yeah.
Because if you don't, there are times this child hurts, but you want to hurt him back almost because he's hurting. And you can only take so much.
Yeah.
And when you're up 15, one time I counted, I was up 15 times during the night with him, until I took him off milk. And that was only a coincidence because I took him off milk for a GI problem.
How old is Kevin now?
5.5.
And how old was he on that tape?
3.5.
Yeah. This can bust up marriages, this kind of thing. I mean, this is a terribly... thanks so much, Mrs. Dash. We're coming back to you in just a little bit. Are the Garcias here?
Yes.
Hi. Would you kindly stand? I want to make sure we can see you. Jamie's with us. Jamie?
No.
Stevie time. I'd talk to you if you had a show.
Go on.
I see you back there. You'll never be a star hiding.
That's right.
That's okay. Listen, you don't have to be a star. You already are one. Jamie, can I show your tape? You don't mind. Okay. Here's Jamie. Is there a mother who hasn't seen this movie? Look at this.
Throw his head back and bounce his body off the floor.
This is a reaction to dust? How old is Jamie here, Mom?
Probably almost two.
Boy, this is a handful. Oh, my. I love my child. I love my child. Please, please.
Take my child.
Please, God, don't let me kill my child. Obviously, this is a clinical setting, the reason for the camera. And look at this. Oh, baby.
Again, he was treated with a dilution of dust. In the correct dilution, putting the drops under the tongue or injecting them in the arm, and you can stop this kind of reaction.
Mrs. Garcia, how'd you know it was dust, or what happened?
We suspected many things. This behavior just happens to be on the tape for dust. We can get this behavior behind orange juice. We can get this behavior behind milk. We can get this behavior behind certain kinds of gum that you get out of the little machine you put in your 2 cents.
He chews the gum and he gets...
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Anything with dyes. Orange juice is a classic. I have two older children that suffer from this also, so when he started throwing nonstop temper tantrums, it's like, Jamie, you want a cookie? Yes. And we throw a tantrum. Jamie, you want, you know, things that he wants to do, and he would throw a tantrum. It wasn't that I was telling him no. Of course, when I told him no, that didn't help either.
Yeah.
You tend to suspect something else.
What a wonderful...
His kindergarten teacher, by the way, now doesn't know that he has any problems at all.
Yeah, that's another thing. A child like this gets into the school and the alphabet soup comes down. Learning LD.
Oh, yes.
And then he's in a special and then his self-esteem goes, eh. Now nobody knows.
Right. Nobody
knows the troubles you've seen.
Well, yes, they do, because I've told the teacher, don't feed him orange juice. He was in a daycare program and I've told them very specifically, please do not feed him oranges or orange juice, and they did one day, and when I came to pick him up at 4 o'clock, it's, Jamie tore apart the room today. He wouldn't sleep, and he threw things out the window, and I said, what did you feed him for lunch? Well, we gave him orange juice. I said, well, I warned you.
Yeah, and we have to wonder how many, imagine orange juice. Here's the point. How realistic is it to expect all teachers everywhere to be this knowing about every individual child that they...
They don't. You can't. You do tend to hope that if you tell them not to give your child something that they will follow through, but you can't even always count on that.
Yeah. Thank you, Mrs. Garcia. We'll be back to you in just a moment. Here is the famous Dr. Doris Rapp, about whom we spoke. You are Clinical Associate Professor of Pediatrics at State University of New York at Buffalo. You are also in private practice, and you wrote a book titled The Impossible Child.
Yes.
At one time or another, I had five of those. Dr. Rapp, let me just, before we get in, let's see the signs of allergies. Number 27, this is in our computer, Brian. Do you know whether your child has an allergy? Look for a child who has typical allergies or allergic relatives. What do you mean, typical allergy?
Hay fever, asthma. Hives, itchy skin,
okay.
That sort of thing.
I know about Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. That's up and down.
You've just
and,
seen it.
Uh-huh. Earns A's one day and F's the next.
Or can write well one time and can't write at another time. They scribble or they rip the paper.
Next slide. Cannot write, draw, or do math at times. Has poor school grades in relation to IQ. Craves certain foods or odors. Next. Is too tired, hyper, irritable, depressed, or vulgar. Never seems to feel well. And here's what you should look for. We're giving you a massive dose of some very complicated research here. But let's take a look. Red earlobes or cheeks. Dark eye circles. Puffy bags under the eyes. I had a neighbor who met all these eye wrinkles. Glassy glazed eyes. Nose rubbing or nose wrinkle. Meaning like a little tick.
This, that. That's this says I've got allergies, and if your child also has hyperactivity, behavior, and learning problems, you might say maybe it's not just the nose that's being affected, but also the brain.
Uh-huh. All right, let's see if we get this now. You're here to say that, first of all, this is not going to fix dyslexia or autism or any of the big stuff, huh?
Well, I'm saying it's not the answer for everyone, but in some children, Even autistic children or epileptic children or children with asthma.
You can see a modified...
There are some children who have these kind of responses. And when these children act this way, many times the ears are red, they have the dark eye circles, they get this glassy look to their eye, and it's telling you it isn't a bad kid. Maybe this child is just having allergies affecting the brain.
I want to talk to some more folks. I'm going to get back to you in just a moment. Who should we chat with? The Baumans. Your son Brad is here. Where are you? Oh, there you are. Hi, Brad. Hi, Mr. Bauman. What's your profile here now on Brad?
Well,
proud dad, because obviously you've solved a problem here.
Right. Ours was, Brad was born, he would eat an ounce and a half a day, that'd be it.
That's all he ate.
Right. Then when he got to be a month old, we'd get 2 ounces in him, and he'd throw it up 6 to 8 feet from himself.
So like projectile vomit. Right.
So then we went to Children's Hospital. They said that he doesn't have the valve between his esophagus and his stomach. So they got to do a Nissen, where they wrap the stomach around the esophagus. And so they did that. And then this is hard.
In other words, the pain is difficult for you to even review this. Right. Huh? Let me help you here just a second. That surgery wasn't necessary, was it?
No.
Okay, what else? What else?
Then he had... Adhesions of the bowels, so he had to have surgery again. Then he has adhesions of the bowels again, he almost died. Then he had adhesions of the bowels again from this very first surgery, and he almost died again.
And what finally took you into the promised land here then? When you finally got rid of all this surgery, what was
well,
it that did
he was in and out of Children's Hospital for his first 9 months of his life.
Yeah.
And then we saw Dr. Rapp on your show. And we started going to her, and she lives a mile and a half from us.
Just by accident.
Right.
And is he off milk?
He's off. No, you can drink milk now with his medicine. The main thing was corn syrup.
This is a child acting just like a child.
And corn syrup is in all your baby formulas.
Corn syrup was no good for him.
Right. Except for one or two baby formulas.
It altered his behavior.
Right.
Corn in the formula.
What?
It was a corn in the formula. When I looked over all the formulas that he had been fed, they all contained corn. And so we just skin tested him and treated him for corn. And that afternoon, he slept 4 hours for the first time in his life. There were times when he was up 20 out of 24 hours crying and screaming. And that night, he slept for the first time. And he was, I think, 15 months and weighed 18 months and weighed 15 pounds or 15 months and weighed 18 pounds. He was very small, tiny.
His first year, he only gained, I think, a pound and a half, 2 pounds. And then doctors at Children's said if we didn't like it, they'd take him away from us because we weren't fifth parents.
Really? The judgment starts on you then. Because you were suggesting that maybe this wasn't the right way to go. That's too bad. Well, it's the crisis is over then, obviously, for you. I mean, you really must feel you saved your child's life, the life of the family with this thing.
Look at
how happy this kid is. We're glad you came, Brad. You are a good-looking young man. As is Ted Holden. Mom, would you kindly stand for just 1 second? And Ted, you're both mic'd. Hey, we got a... How old are you now? About 36, Ted?
16.
You're 16. Tell me about his history, Mom.
Ted had all the symptoms up there as a preschooler. The circles, the colic, the hyper behavior. Although, as a preschooler, he was manageable. Our biggest problem came with school.
Really?
He lasted 3 weeks. The phone started ringing.
We can't handle your kid.
You got a problem, Mom.
What grade?
Kindergarten. Repeated kindergarten. Carried on failing, not reading. At 10, still could not read. This was a very frustrated child, a child who had rageous, destroyed things. Tore out the screen at 7 and stood on the second story and said, I'm going to jump. I'm going to kill myself.
Really? How old?
7.
Do you remember that, Ted? As you look back on that now, you must have been just a very desperately unhappy little boy.
I was really depressed. I was continuously told by people at school, the teacher saying that I'm dumb and stupid and that I couldn't learn anything and that I'd be some Mac at a gas station.
Yeah. That crushes you good, doesn't it?
And I was really depressed, and I felt stupid inside, and I had no self-esteem, and I felt horrible.
Yeah.
How are you doing now in school?
Well, last year in grade 9, I got an 80 average, and at the advanced level.
For you? At the upper, where all the eggheads are, you got 80, yeah. Huh? Okay.
And that,
of course, that's an area totally unfamiliar to the host of our show, but I've read about it. And what else, Ted, you wanted to say?
For once in my life, I felt really good that I managed something and that what everything they said before is like, I knew I was right and I could learn. And it was a long, slow process.
Right. What'd you do? I don't have a lot of time, Mom. Just what's this magic?
We did a lot of things for Ted. We managed diet-wise with him from the time he was 5 up until 13. But the best that we could do for him was keep taking things away. And finally, we decided we had to give him more. And we went to Dr. Rapp. And within a very short length of time, he turned into a normal human being for the first time in his life.
Is he off milk?
No.
Dairy's okay for him?
He eats almost everything now.
But what was the big, give me some of the foodstuffs that mattered back at that time.
The biggest ones were probably sugar and dairy products at that time.
He can eat it now.
Huh?
He can eat it now because he's been treated for these foods. The problem the mother was faced with is there was a gradually increasing list of foods and things he couldn't eat.
Yeah.
And at some point she came to us and we treated him for these foods. Now he can eat them. And that's the difference. What are you going to do with a child who's sensitive to milk, wheat, eggs, chocolate, corn, and sugar? You know, what are you going
to
feed them?
Yeah.
Well, if you get them treated for their allergies, then they can eat the food.
So you actually, he's able to consume dairy products now because you immunized him with concentrated...
Basically, that's it. Yes.
So you shot him up with milk?
Instead of ragweed and grass, we shot him up with milk. That's it. You're right. I don't quite like your term, but it's okay.
And it's been a long time. For a long time in immunology that you give the people... That's what this...
Well, actually, wait. There's a lot of doctors that don't believe that this is possible. All I can say is it is possible, and there are scientific studies that are coming out now to document it. But the children of today can't wait 20 years for large, expansive, expensive million-dollar studies when we can help them sometimes in a day or two or an hour or two.
And Ted makes the point that this is a very critical time, and this is when you figure out who you are. And if everybody's telling you you're some sort of a weirdo or different, you're going to...
If he wasn't turned around at 13, he wouldn't be where he is today. And where would he be as an adult?
Right. Thank you both. I'll get back to you in a moment. I do have to break here. Let me say before I do break that on the stage with Dr. Rapp is Mary Callahan, who loves her son, Tony, and he loves her. And here, this woman is not a patient of Dr. Rapp. We don't want this to appear to be exclusively the research of Dr. Rapp. Here's Mary Callahan, who independently discovered much the same information that Dr. Rapp has been using in her practice all these years and turned her own son Tony's life around by changing his diet, essentially.
All I did is take him off cow's milk, just replace soy milk in place of cow's milk in his diet.
That's the only thing you had to do?
That was it. Of course, at that point, for 2.5 years, he'd been on milk, and he was diagnosed as autistic and retarded and was spending hours and hours every day screaming and banging his head on the floor, so there was a lot of work to do to catch him up. But we didn't really discover that the whole cause of it was milk until he was 5.5 and functioning like a normal child, and a substitute teacher gave him 2 cartons of milk for lunch, and an hour later, I had an autistic child again.
Now, he is not autistic.
No.
They thought he was autistic because...
He had all the signs of autism. It was an obvious diagnosis, but it was
all he had to do was take out the milk.
Right.
Just a little too much fooling around over here. Obviously, these children will have to be disciplined. Look at these healthy young people on the stage here. Incidentally, the allergies to which we referred, which caused these kinds of behavioral aberrations, how do we want to put it, are found mostly in boys.
Yes. Typical allergies are mostly in boys, and these kinds of allergies, the ratio is probably 4 or 5 to 1.
Now, let's understand this. I'm impressed with how much fun they're having. Prior to all this discovery regarding allergies and diet, this would be a hostile confrontation, I assume.
Yes. Yes. They bite, they hit, they pinch, they kick. They squeeze, they they do a lot of things that are unacceptable.
Yeah. Do you see the teeth? You see that? Look at this up here. Who is that up there? Well, we need some. Good look. Boy, we should all have this much fun. Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to ask Dr. Rath if sure. she finds that these children actually crave the substances that they're allergic to, that they eat them to excess.
Yes, most of the children do crave the very foods to which they're sensitive. Some of them will get out of bed in the middle of the night and steal the sugar, and the mother will find them eating the sugar in the middle of the night, or even flour or wheat, that sort of thing. The adults crave the chocolate and the beer, that sort of thing, when they're sensitive.
Dr. Rapp, how yes. do you tell when there's multiple allergies? I mean, by eliminating the milk, yes, all right, and the gal went on to the soy. But how do you find when there's three or four different allergies involved?
You have to say, first of all, is it something inside your house, outside your house, a food or a chemical? If your child has a change in personality when you put gas in the car, you have to say maybe it's the smell of the gas or the perfume or the cleaning solution that you use on a certain day on the floor. If your child is always worse outside when the grass is being cut, you have to think about grass pollen. In the fall, you have to think about ragweed pollen.
You're really a Sherlock Holmes then.
Yes, but it's common sense. If your child's always worse after they eat, as many of the mothers said, and they get a bowel problem and they stop eating for 2 days and all of a sudden they're an angel, you should say to yourself, maybe it's a food. And the last thing is, if your child's worse on the day you clean your house or they go to bed night, they go to bed fine at night, they get up in the morning and they're stuffy or asthmatic or hyper or nasty, you've got to say it's either something they ate before they went to bed, or the feather pillow, or the dust in the bedroom, or something like right. that. A lot of it is common sense.
Is Mrs. Callahan lucky to have milk as the only offending diet?
She's very lucky. Most people are most children or adults are sensitive to much more than just one food.
Yeah. Are these allergies ever outgrown, or is it with them for life?
If they're lucky, they are. But many many hyperactive children quiet down or they get into a busy job. They don't become librarians. But some of them never adjust and they can't hold a job and they just are irritable or difficult all the time.
Some of them get talk shows and they get to run around. Yeah.
Do you think all children should be deprived of sugar or just wait until reaction shows?
No, we don't want to give the impression that every child has trouble from milk or sugar or orange juice. It's different things for different youngsters, and you have to figure out what is it that bothers this one instead of this one. It might be dust. It might be ragweed pollen. Another point I want to make is some of the youngsters, I have one youngster, a teenage girl, who becomes suicidal every year during the tree pollen season. And when she comes in, she writes pictures and says, I wish I was dead, and they're very negative pictures. And then when you give her the correct dilution of a tree allergy extract, she writes a beautiful picture, and she's pleasant, and she's nice, and she's not talking about suicide anymore.
Show them the signature where the child writes his name. I'm not sure that
the child writes.
Yeah, where the child writes his name and the signature changes.
And it shows the writing. Well,
yeah.
This
yeah.
is Robert. While he's being tested for a number of foods and items, and he has no trouble, and then all of a sudden we test him for wheat, and you can see what happens to his handwriting.
Yeah, you can't see that.
It isn't.
But the final one is the wheat test?
The bottom one is when he's trying to write his name after he's been tested for wheat.
So obviously no cereal for Robert, is that,
that it? There was no cereal for Robert for almost a year, even though he was on treatment, but now he can go to a pizza party like he had for his birthday, and he was all right.
Because you immunized him
because he's been treated. The allergist would say, don't say immunized, but I say I used a stock allergy extract, and I treated him like I would a patient with ragweed allergy.
This is a remarkable issue for us. Let me just say, in our own recent history of putting on television programs like this, the response to these programs is staggering. Now, what that tells us is, and this does not mean that what we're saying here should be written in tablets. This is an evolving science within medicine. But it's clear to us that there are apparently homes out there, I mean untold numbers of homes, living with the agony of a child who just cannot be controlled. It's like the omen has suddenly come to your house, and it's your kid.
And the mothers feel it's their fault. And the children feel it's their fault, and that's what's wrong.
And you step forward to say, this may be what the child is either ingesting or being exposed to. It could be an allergy. Here are the signs of allergy. Show them this Brian, and then we'll get these questions here. We need the monitors for this. Okay, number 54. Remember we mentioned
that's
rubbing the nose.
That's the allergic salute.
But, you know, I mean, that's the what?
Allergic salute.
I see. Yeah. This he's responding to a recent Donahue show, this kid. Next slide. What's this red ear?
This is the red ear that you see when they start to react. They have this change in personality at the same time their ears become red.
Next slide. Same thing.
There's another red ear.
Next slide. See the
These are the circles under the eyes. Blue and red or pink and black circles.
Next slide.
And these are the puffiness. You see the little bags under the eyes? This boy's eyes were slits until we took him off of milk.
Next.
And these are the wrinkles under the eyes that you see in children who have allergies.
Next.
This is the wrinkle that's on the nose after you push your nose up in the air a lot, which again indicates that you have nose allergies.
That's a pot belly here.
That, when you have food allergies, your body gives you a message. You belch, you burp, you pass gas regularly.
That's gas causing the pot belly, isn't it?
Right. And you also frequently have bad breath, and the cause is frequently milk, wheat, or eggs.
Excellent.
There's a tongue that looks sort of mottled and patchy. That's characteristic of some children who have food allergies.
Now, this next one is curious. Let's see number 63, Brian. Here are our post-allergic. Sucks Royal. How old is the kid? 11. I see it.
This is an 11-year-old boy, and he was perfectly fine until we started to check him for the air in his school. And his parents said that when he went to school, he became vulgar and did all sorts of unacceptable things. And in the office, he came in, and he was fine, and we made a special extract of the air in his school, and then we skin tested him with this. And when we gave him a dilution of the air from the school, and he didn't know what he was being tested for, he started to get very vulgar and writes these terrible notes and makes little signs with his hands and says dirty things. And then when we gave him the right dilution, he quieted down, and he was calm again and acted normal and wasn't vulgar.
Right. And what's critical here is that the parent of that kind of child feels a failure. They've raised a child who is not behaving. The judgment is brought against not only the child but themselves. And the kid may be biochemically responding to an allergy.
That's right. Something. It's not always being recognized, unfortunately. And
these are, I'll tell you this, they'll never accuse them of being shy, will they? They're our future. Look at this. Future talk show host, no doubt about it. Yes, ma'am. We've got a lot of work to do here in this audience that has been not had the opportunity yet.
Yes, the medication that's given, is it just for the allergies, and how long are they treated for?
I don't understand the first part of
how
the
long,
question.
How long does the treatment have to proceed for this to be effective? I mean, you know, she wants to know if she's got a kid like this, how long is she going to be worrying
about
it?
Sometimes if you just put them on the diet, they're tremendously improved within a week, providing you omitted the food that tends to cause the trouble.
But how long do you have to modify the diet? You know, is it forever, for life?
All right. If you want to eat the food, sometimes you have to take the allergy treatment, and we give it under the tongue for a period of months or years. As far as correcting the diet, it depends on how sensitive you are. At this point, some of them can eat the foods every 4 days and they have no trouble. But if they binge on it, then they're apt to have difficulty.
Over here.
Yes. Yeah. Are there any figures of how many kids have this condition?
We really don't know because a lot of doctors don't recognize it. In Feingold's book, he says that in some schools, 4-5% have this sort of problem. In other schools, he said, have as many as 40% of the children affected. So I think in different areas, depending on diets and other things,
right.
And also whether the doctors can diagnose it or not.
Dr. Rapp's book is titled The Impossible Child. It's a guide for caring teachers and parents in school and at home. Here's her effort to help you with a child who may just be more than getting on your nerves. Why do I have Alka-Seltzer?
Because this is something that helps about 60% of the patients. When you have a child and their ears get red, they get the glassy eyes, and suddenly they switch from Dr. Jekyll to Mr. Hyde. Sometimes if it's due to a food and you use that, the child will quiet down in 10 minutes. And it also tends to help headaches that might be caused by something you ate, or asthma, or even a stuffy nose. It doesn't help everyone. It doesn't have aspirin. It's in gold foil, not blue foil.
You want the gold foil.
The gold foil.
Because the gold foil what?
It
no
has
aspirin.
No aspirin.
All right.
It can prevent the attack or stop it after
Thank
you've
you.
Taken it.
Well, I guess we don't need you. We got an audience, don't we?
Doctor, do you think that perhaps all children should be checked for these allergies routinely?
No, I don't think so, but I think that there are many children who have this problem, and it isn't being recognized by either the parents or the physicians.
I just wanted to know if, when they're treated for these allergies, do other allergies or other symptoms develop later on if one is cured or an antidote for it is used?
Sometimes this happens. As you get older, the areas of the body affected by allergies may change.
I think that the parents of these children should inform the teachers in response to what Jamie's mother said before, so that the teachers will be aware of the reason that the child is not permitted to have certain foods and aware of the
right.
child's reaction to
they
certain foods.
They frequently tell the teachers, but
Ms.
the teachers
Garcia.
Don't listen.
I have four children. I have told them why. Some teachers listen and
yes,
some don't.
I agree. I think there are still some among us in the adult community who want to bring a judgment to this kid. The reason he's finished is because he's a selfish little kid, and it's just, we've had some disappointed, and that's the real. And his mother lets him get away with murder, and that's why we're going to, I'm not going to tolerate it. Didn't you have, how was Tony's school, how did his teachers respond to Tony's
The first school that Tony went to was a special preschool because he had already been diagnosed as being autistic and retarded. And the attitude I found at the school was, you caused this problem, leave us alone and we'll solve it. When I went in and said, you know, I want to work with diet, I want to try maybe multivitamins or anything, I was told that I had false hope and that
yeah.
nothing would
what
ever help
What was Tony
him.
Doing that was so distracting?
The temper tantrum we saw of Jamie, that was Tony 4 to 12 hours a day, every day. Between temper tantrums, he spun the wheels on his trucks, he stared into light bulbs, he did not talk, he didn't even have eye contact.
And look at this good-looking guy now. Do you remember those times, Tony? Remember those times when you were not happy? And
not really.
It's been a while. How old are you now?
9.
You look like you play for the Dodgers or something. what a happy-looking child this is.
Oh, you know, we were told he would probably never talk, potty train, or feed himself, and that his IQ was somewhere around 50, and now he's doing
yeah.
well in third grade.
I want to get this straight now. Somebody at school gave him 2 pints of milk?
Oh, 2 cartons of milk for lunch when he was 5 and a half. By that time, he had neither diagnosis anymore. He was doing very well by 5 and a half. We picked him up right after lunch, and within an hour, he was screaming, and he wouldn't look at me, wouldn't talk to me. And he was spraying water from a Windex bottle in front of his eyes, and that was all I got. He would do the rest of the day.
Medical Allergy Relief Foundation?
No, Research Foundation.
Research
That's
Foundation.
Where they can get the book, The Impossible Child, that tells about these things.
That's Box 60, Buffalo, New York, 14223. How much is the book?
$10.
$10. Sir?
Is there any special age that you could tell, like the earliest stage of life, you could tell that a kid is hyperactive?
Yes, you really can.
Let's do that. Give us the infant... number 31, and I lost
In the fetus, the infant will kick the mother so hard that sometimes their ribs are bruised, and then later on...
Hold on 1 second. I'm sorry, Doc. Many formula changes, meaning if you find yourself always looking for the formula that's going to bring the child down, then you probably have an allergy. Prolonged colic, unwillingness to smile, inability to sleep well. Next slide. Frequent spitting or vomiting, reluctance to be cuddled, profuse perspiration, constant crying or irritability, prolonged frequent temper tantrum, walking before 10 months. What?
Some of these children walk at 8 months. You can't hold them down. They're so hyper they can't. They
yeah.
get out of the crib very early.
Doctor, at what point do you decide where does the personality disorder and the allergies begin? I mean, when do you stop trying to analyze? You know, where's the bottom
Well,
line?
You're trying to say what's the chicken, which is the chicken and which is the egg. I think that if they have a lot of allergies, they'll develop some behavior and psychological problems, and they'll need counseling later on. But you look at the history. You've got a lot of allergic relatives, and you've got other allergies. Think that allergies, unusual oddball allergies, may be the cause of somebody's troubles, especially if they have this look we talked about. Yes.
I was just wondering, is there ever a point at which Ritalin is necessary or that you can't find the allergy?
There are some children that need Ritalin, right. But
do you prescribe it?
But if no, I never do. But if you have a nail in your shoe causing a sore in your foot, what's the treatment? A Band-Aid or to take out the nail? Let's try to figure out why people are ill and stop using so many drugs.
For the doctors who don't believe in what you do, have they seen your results and how do they explain them?
They keep saying there are no scientific studies. There are 6 single-blinded studies, over 20 double-blinded studies, and some of these are done extremely well. We have movies and videotapes and lots of things, but some of the doctors don't want to see it. But in all justification, let me say that it's hard to get our articles in the very best, the cream de la cream journals. And so many of the doctors have read that sugar does not cause problems. And when the latest article came out saying that sugar doesn't cause problems, that's when I brought in Kevin and I fed him sugar cubes and said, what do you mean it doesn't cause trouble? It depends on how the studies are done.
You wanted to say, I'm sorry, Ms. Kelly.
Tony's doctor still doesn't accept the milk bit, as he puts it. And he's seen Tony since he was supposedly retarded until now. And the medical profession has a real problem with anything related to nutrition solving something that serious.
As a kid, I was allergic to milk and orange juice. And I want to find out if I was allergic to anything else. So I took a cytotoxic test. And out of 150 foods and other things, I found out that I was allergic to 25. And I eliminated about 21 of them.
Right.
Some of them I take occasionally.
Did it help?
Yeah.
It did help.
Of course, yeah. Nothing you took caused baldness.
No.
I would like to offer hope to the mothers of these children. I see my son 40 years ago looking like these children. He has grown up. He has become one of the top engineers in IBM. And he's doing very well.
Well, look at who his mom is. You shouldn't be surprised. Yes.
I just want to know if any of them, like, physically ever, like, hurt other children and how their teachers actually did discipline them in the classroom.
That's a good point. They not only hurt the younger children and the families, but the mothers are frequently battered and bruised. And they come in with bruises on their body because they've been kicked and hit and pinched, and the mothers don't complain.
You've had your share of wrestling matches, I assume.
Yes, so. From the time he was a week old and started screaming, he always screamed plus kicked me at the same time. Yeah. He was very violent when he was having a temper tantrum.
Do you think there's a lot of children who are sick?
A lot of what?
You don't.
Children.
I'm not sure the numbers, because doctors aren't telling parents to try this so we can find out who they are. But since my book about Tony came out, I've heard from about 60 parents with a similar...
Is there a reason why it's boys more than girls?
We don't know.
You sure? Okay, Mrs. Garcia, I'll give you a chance, please. Let me just say, fighting for Tony is Mary Callahan's very, very personal and informative account of her struggle with her... Look at this young man. Is that a good-looking kid or not? And a happy one, too. Wasn't always the case. And here's what Mom found out all by herself. It's amazing what you can do if you get the right mom. Mrs. Garcia wanted to say.
Girls have the same problem, but teachers react to them differently. When my daughter would hit somebody, she didn't get the response from the teacher that when my son got.
So boys are rewarded in a sense, in a neurotic way.
Boys are allowed to do it, and they expect it out of boys, so it gets out of hand, and they don't mention it.
I did not. I'm sorry, Brian. I should have given the address again. For those of you interested in Dr. Rapp's book titled The Impossible Child, the address is PARF Box 60, Buffalo, New York. The zip is 14223. The book is $10. Yes, ma'am?
Yes. Are these allergies hereditary?
They tend to run in families, and if you've got milk allergies, it might cause one symptom in one person. One might be hyperactive. Another might have bowel problems. Another might wet the bed. It just depends. Another will have ear problems, fluid behind the eardrum.
Are you a PhD or MD?
I'm an MD and board certified in allergy and pediatrics.
Yeah.
Excuse me, how would you deal with a best friend or relative who has that behavior?
Find out if they want to be helped. If they don't want to be helped, there's not much you can do. If they want to be helped, there are many how-to books, not only the two that were mentioned here, but there are books in the library that will help you figure out the answers.
Yes. Yes. Where? Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
I just want to congratulate Tony's mom for having done a wonderful job all by herself, and that boy is certainly a lucky little boy.
Yeah. Yeah. You're using the whole set. Brad and Kevin are having